Thank you. thanks everyone for coming out tonight. Really excited to kick this off. First of three nights here at KAJE. Thank you so much to Kate for hosting us and making this really awesome already. And we're going to start things off with Emmanuel. So here we go.
How's it going? I was not ready to vibe, but I'm gonna get ready to vibe. Just need 1 second. Okay. I'm Emmanuel Olunkwa. I just do things. I was talking to Craig earlier. Bios suck. Introducing yourselves kind of sucks, but. I think about things and sometimes I make them. But lately I've been writing a lot or thinking about writing a lot. So I'm gonna do that. This is something I wrote a few months ago, but it's called Time Today. And I don't know if I feel this way, but by the end of it, hopefully, we'll see. What to do with the time, living it all, I guess. Traveling these days makes everything feel the same as when I'm standing, left in a perpetual state of some sort of spinning. Say, talk, express your abstract mind. Lately, today's felt like a lot like tomorrow, but tomorrow always feels like today. Keegan says, I seem present. I guess me feeling pressed registers as some sort of perceived presence, dial tone, a static moment merging as connection. 2-7, 27, 21, which ultimately means nothing. The grand sum of the total is a zero-sum game. I felt myself this morning and it felt good. I couldn't feel anything yesterday but the pressure. F tells me when I'm older, I'm going to look back at myself in this moment and feel different, but I want to tell him that I'm constantly confronting parts of myself now. Spent the month of September in Paris, not speaking, but doing everything French. I stayed on a rooftop in a converted studio apartment in the 15th alone. Felt a lot like being 15 and alone. Los Angeles doesn't call my name anymore now that I live in New York. The studio in Paris didn't have a mirror, so there was nothing for me to mirror. So I could only feel myself, sit with parts of myself, as they say. So much inside and outside of me these days, those feelings, this weather, and matter. The things I once wanted to know now hold me, but I now know the absence of fear is loneliness. Sat alone thinking I would say something, trying to submerge and package what I feel into something I once felt. But only concepts and prescriptive ideas come to mind. I want more of who or what, I don't know. I want someone or something to consume, or maybe I myself want to be consumed or dominated. Oh, what to do with time. Thanks. Am I good? You good? We're good? Okay. Those were words in a space. Poetry. And this is also poetry, but this is, when I'm thinking idle thoughts. This is called Metaphor for Eternity, and it's funny, it's like, I actually wrote this in kind of vignettes. Like, my boyfriend at the time was away, and like, I was like, oh my God, like, you're gone, and I'm like writing these things. Isn't this crazy? And then I sent them to him, and it's fucking crazy that I did that. But here we go. So this is Metaphor for Eternity. They want us to talk about race and the race to win their attention and lose ourselves. Talk about being black, they say. Ask me about the African American experience, I say. But then stutter. Being black and speaking black ain't being black and talking about being black. being Black as being green, feeling blue, tasting orange. I never spoke about race. I told all the lies they told me to tell, the lies they taught me to told. Say what you say the way we want you to say it. Speak about race, they say, in this race. Make it up as you go when we say go. The race you win is the race they told you to lose. Being African American ain't in the race. Being Black ain't in the race. Being Black ain't seeing red, ain't feeling blue. Being Black ain't being, ain't seeing, ain't feeling. But being Black be doing, be showing that shit. Fuck a conversation, fuck a race. We ain't and can't all win, so lose the race. I didn't know how to just tell them I needed time. Space to understand and be left with unfettered thoughts, dragging my life around, thinking it would become okay, grasping for it to be more than an accessory, a reality, a world that I'm living within that isn't outside of me, stumbling, fumbling through the thick of it all, waiting for the enlightenment. But I have enough white men in my life, already been deep in enough white men in my life. Talk about everything but what is really on my mind, waiting for the wrong person to ask me the right question. Sure, I'll talk to you for the next 30 minutes. No, I don't know anything about affect theory, myself, Blackness, or Fanon. Give all my time away to those who aren't even concerned, thinking about what today could have been if I said no, but I didn't mean it. I usually mean what I say in between what I said and what you understand. Stay saying something you hearing differently. When I feel like I'm always telling you where I'm at if you only listen. Lean into it, and I'm always only on display. Just hiding in plain sight, shouting, lingering, lounging, but loving you. I just need some time with you, some of you inside of me. But now that you're away, I feel that you're gone. So I got time. My body is a labored hotel. My body is a hotel of labor. My body labored the hotel. The hotel labored my body. My body bodied my body. I'm embodied by my body. My body can't body. I'm bodied. Okay, I forgot about these. If my body was the vessel, is the vessel, was the vessel, I'd have some autonomy over myself. Under the weight of it all, I kind of feel like Adele. You know, she uses her hands when she sings. Under the weight of it all, kind of feel like I'm singing like rolling in the deep. You know, I'm like. I'm just gonna start over. If my body was the vessel, is the vessel, was the vessel, I'd have some autonomy over myself. Under the weight of it all, I found my desire to be more, to see what I wanted as less of a material construction, but more as a material to construct. I wanted to be comfortable, but comfort exists purely as an exercise for gain, an incentive, a commodity. But what I didn't know, I came to know as something I didn't trust myself with before. Time taught me that I don't know shit. Time ain't shit. But now my body is a vessel, my mind, my time, all on and in my mind. That's Metaphor for Eternity. And Okay. I'm just gonna read a little bit of this piece that I feel is like completely encapsulates the architecture of my mind. Things that I'm made to think about, though I just like to think I would prefer to not think about them. But being gay sometimes and doing gay shit, and art and New York City and other people who are gay and do gay shit. And also being Black, I guess. So this is a story of David Bojanowicz. I wrote around the documentary that debuted maybe early 2021. So I'll just read, there are a few vignettes, and so I'll just read a few of them so you can get the taste, and if you can go back and you can do your own thing. A few weeks ago, I found myself in bed watching an online screening of Wajonarit's Fuck You Faggot Fucker, a documentary directed by Chris McKim, which showcases and explores the artist David Wajonarit's speaking, living, and leaning into his truth. I hesitated writing about him, worried that it could seem that I'm interested in a black or gay artist simply on a basis of our ideological similarities. But my art and theory education didn't include Wajonarit. Instead, I learned about him on assignment as an editorial assistant at Art Forum. I went to document the 2018 Wajonarit's retrospective at the Whitney, David Wajonarit's History Keeps Me Awake at Night. I didn't know who David was at the time, what he was supposed to mean to me. I naively entered the gallery, scanned the works on the wall, and found and photographed what I thought to be the most compelling works in the show, making for an early departure. A month after the Whitney opening, I found myself in the basement of the McNally Jackson bookstore on Prince Street for reading and release of Weight of the Earth, the tape journals of David Wajonarit. Again, I was totally green and ignorant of who and what this person was and symbolized to people. At the front of the room, David Velasco, the editor of Art Forum, was reading the introduction he wrote for the book. He spoke about engaging with DW's live journals that mostly consisted of him recounting his memories late at night into early morning or while on a road trip heading from New York out west. A few key bits have stuck with me since. Something happens when I read David, where I imagine I'm him, or he's my friend, or he's not dead, or I think what he thinks of me, or like maybe he thinks he's me. But I don't really feel bad about it, like I might with someone else. Maybe it's because his name is David too, or maybe it's because I sense that he wants it, his searching moral voice. A bottom's voice, a voice that says, use me if you've been used and enjoy being used because I've been used and enjoy being used too. In my daily life, I find ways to protect myself, not because I own my body or have anything except maybe a privileged relationship to it. I'm just a freeholder, but because, as David has said, or actually has written elsewhere, survival is such a lovely thing, such a transient thing. Survival is a moral good, possibly the only moral good, but my survival is not for myself, but for others. I alone don't get to decide what matters. It's only when we meet that this becomes something. My body is precious and special because it's yours, if you want it. That's my favorite part. just so you know, but there's more that I wrote. But David died of AIDS in 1992, less than 2 months after his 38th birthday. In Wajonarit, the documentary opens with David speaking over collaged footage of a black and white American flag and then bleeds into footage of a roller coaster navigating its tracks as he recounts, "When I was diagnosed with this virus, it didn't take me long to realize that I contracted a disease society as well." A few moments later, we're thrust into his apartment, witnessing him having a telephone conversation. "It could be construed as critical," he says, "but if you're doing a show about AIDS, there's absolutely no way that you can separate politics from AIDS. Bottom line is, I might be dying of AIDS in America in 1989. Isn't that political? I don't have health insurance, and I don't have economical access to adequate health care. Isn't that political?" To try to pretend that the subject of AIDS does not have a political tinge to it is ridiculous. Immediately following the call, we see David grapple with the frustration of not having recorded the conversation himself for his personal archive, though he was being recorded by a friend's camera. It's a cruel thing to watch a video of a fallen hero, someone who comes to represent a moment or serves as a stand-in for certain types of people who are concerned with the livelihood of others, though using their own body and existence as a vessel. An article promoting the documentary Wajonarit's Fuck You Faggot Fucker, which premiered last year's Doc NYC Festival, stated he was an artist and activist among contemporaries Keith Haring and Robert Mapplethorpe. I struggle with this level of narrativizing because it washes the palette and rigor of David's life away and groups him with people who had different practices or agendas with varying priorities. To be fair, though, They were friends, Keith and David, and worked at the Danceteria together in Times Square. It's not to say that Wajornowicz's way of existing is superior to theirs, but more that he often experienced and lived his life in the embodied, often putting his body and his mind on the line for things he believed in, or as they say in the church, he practiced what he preached. One of the things that haunts me most from the documentary and Wajornowicz's legacy writ large is how he's often posed to have been a savior when all he wanted to be saved wasn't saved himself. I'll read one more, then I'm gonna bounce. Okay. In the months following, it's kind of long, I'm gonna keep it short. In the months following his final homecoming show at the PAL Gallery in the Garden in November of 1990, David and his longtime collaborator, Marion Shimoma, had their final dance, taking a road trip to Death Valley, where through his failing health, David requested assistance on staging a photograph of him in the dirt as if he was buried. We then see photos documenting the process of the two of them submerging David's shoulders, neck, and face in sand and earth, which amounts to his final piece of work, untitled Face and Dirt. In the concluding months of his life in 1992, the Museum of Modern Art vigorously collected Hujar's work in Fire, a piece from David's Four Elements series, for its permanent collection. In the last moment of the documentary, we find David's boyfriend, Tom Raffenbart, and his sister Anita and Wendy Ofsloff and Penny Pinkleton of the gallery navigating the Whitney retrospective, where we land on Something from Sleep, Dream, a collage of a black and white clips of newspaper with an orange dinosaur that reads Wajornowicz traveling down the spine. Tom notes that David wasn't feeling well at the time that he made the piece and how it reminded him of the inevitability of extinction of the dinosaur in Wajornowicz. I hate writing these kinds of texts about a person who lived with such an arresting interiority, who was lost to chance and negligence. David wasn't a superhero who possessed any special abilities, but he was someone who threw himself headlong into whatever he was doing, all the while remaining empathetic yet critical. It's hard to watch the world turn as people are cast aside without healthcare, without home, without hope, who are subjected to perform and bend to the will of the market to have a chance for basic survival. It's dizzying to spend time with someone who gave so much of themselves, who faced the same issues that we're calling on action for today, healthcare and housing. We've all toiled and convinced ourselves that the work that we're doing is essential, but it has all started to feel performative. People are dying who are uninsured. We're subjected and positioned to be individuals in a body of people, but we don't prioritize the collective good. To be plagued with the same anxieties as David isn't something that should be romanticized because it's repulsive. We're all spun out on our efforts to make change, but the only thing that we've perfected is how to perform the narrative of how things haven't changed but desperately need to. In the last moments of the documentary, we are met with the final words of David, where he says, "The work that anybody does as an artist, if it doesn't reflect resistance, then they're helping a system of control become more perfect." He contends, "We rise to greet the state, to confront the state," to which I say, "to make changes instead of performing a desire for change." Thank you.
on.
Thank you. Thank you.
out one more for you, and then Raina is up.
Thank you.
set up. And that is our program for tonight. One, 2 weeks from today, we still have a few spots for that. So if you want to come back, it's possible.
Yeah. Be better.
Thank you. Hey, everyone. It's nice to see you all. Thank you, Emmanuel, for a beautiful opening. And Das Audit for gorgeous music, Kit, for these incredible visuals. And thanks, Eve, for extending this invitation. I'm Gavilán Rayna Russom, for those of you who don't know. And I'm going to play a piece that's a work in progress. Working title is Two Waters. And it's, let's say, very, 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 very loosely based around some inspiration from an essay by Solomar Otero called Yemaya Yochung, Queering the Vernacular of the Waters. And that essay is in turn, I wouldn't even say maybe one very, just loosely based on and inspired by an essay by Lydia Cabrera. And so without too much words, what really spoke to me about this written work is this idea of the waters, in this case the fresh water, the salty water, the river, the ocean, and especially the places where these waters mix, the estuaries, as an example of the fluidity, the permeability of experience, of time, of bodies, of identity. And here where we are, you know, which has been my home for quite some time, this place that is temporarily and under much contention called New York City, the ancestral homeland of the Lenape, the Munsee Lenape and Canarsie peoples. We have so much of this, like, as you know, as anybody who spent any time here knows, all the waters are mixing. All these places, you know, Gowanus Canal is right over here. You know, we're at this place that's actually a giant estuary, the entire five boroughs. You know, only freshwater river actually in the five boroughs is the Bronx River, and that's because it's coming down and moving, eventually joining the Harlem and Hudson Rivers. So we're here in this amazing place where this kind of liminality that Solomar talks about in her essay, that Lydia Cabrera refers to, in these West African traditions that were innovated in 19th century Cuba, that they speak about this, this sort of radical way of thinking about being. So, again, very, 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 I don't know how many varies I said. These are my sources of inspiration. I wanted to share that with you before I begin. Hope you enjoy the music, and it's been beautiful to spend already this night here at KAJE, and thank you, Kate, and the rest of the folks here for, you know, for this wonderful space as well that we're all sharing tonight. And so without further ado. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks so much.